thank you, Dennis, for joining us to discuss some of the histories and traditions of Sankt Hans Aften. You are one of the, I would say, Danish American experts on this topic that I know of, having attended and hosted a Sankt Hans Aften, as you've told me, nearly every year of your life. Is that correct?
Correct.
Let's start off just with some definitions. Could you explain just the term Sankt Hans Aften?
Sankt Hans is Saint John the Baptist. Aften is, of course, the day before his feast day. His feast day in Denmark is the 24th of June. Sankt Hans Aften is celebrated on the 23rd of June, but it also coincides with the solstice. There's a reason that it's on the 23rd and not the 21st, but it is the day of the extreme sunlight, which was a pagan festival long before the Catholic Church was involved. The church appropriated it for the feast day of St. John the Baptist because under biblical tradition, St. John the Baptist was born 6 months before Christ. They were cousins. Elizabeth and Mary were sisters, Elizabeth being St. John the Baptist's mother.
When the church introduced its layer on top of this the celebration, did they change a lot as far as you know?
They tried to. They tried to make the following day a feast day with required attendance, which would ruin the pagan festival the night before, which led to everybody being asleep. It was not a well-attended feast day. The day before the birth of St. John the Baptist celebration was a pagan festival, and it remained in its pagan form even basically up until today. It's the longest celebration, certainly in Denmark. And it's the second largest celebration in Denmark, second only to Christmas.
What would you describe as the critical essential elements of a traditional Sankt Hans Aften?
First of all, you must have a fire. And the fire is in Denmark and in Norway and in the other Scandinavian countries, either on a very high hill or on a beach. You hold off lighting that fire until that sun is halfway down the horizon. And then you keep it going until the sun rises. Element number two is that when you come to celebrate, you celebrate until the sunrise. See, and I feel sorry for people in the United States who celebrate Sankt Hans Aften. They have to put in a lot more work to make it to sunrise than people in Norway and Denmark, because Norway and Denmark is much further north, and so therefore making it to sunrise means you get to be done about 2 or 3 o'clock, whereas in Iowa, making it to sunrise, you have to wait till 4:30, 5 o'clock. So the party lasts longer, but you still can make it till sunrise, which is so important.
Okay. And so let's discuss what you bring to the fire.
You must bring three things with you. You must bring a candle, a witch, and a broom. So the witch concept has to be understood in the name that's applied. Hexa comes from the same English word of putting a hex on somebody. The Danes, pagan Scandinavians all felt that the devil was at the weakest moment when there was the most sun. Traditionally burned the witch to force evil to go back to Harzen or Blocksberg, two different mountains in Germany. So you bring a witch, because it's right at the end of the school year, children bring the report cards they weren't happy with. So the witches can be metaphorical as well as figurative. And everybody is encouraged to bring whatever witch they want to burn. I'm an attorney, and so I always burn decisions that I did not approve of in the prior year. And so that's just a bunch of paper that I burn. But others will burn. A carpenter came and burned a hammer that he almost lost his finger on because he hit the finger on the hammer. And so there are all different kinds of things that are thrown in the fire. And it's thrown in the fire at various different times. Now, also, there is one big witch. And the witches can come as on poles as high as 12 feet. The goal is to get the fire so big that you light the witch on fire. So the longer the pole, the longer the witch is suspended over the fire, the more everybody has to work at building a fire until the witch catches fire. But of course, your goal here is to get rid of the evil by burning the witch.
And what about the brooms?
Okay. You have to remember that in Denmark, the barley harvest is about to begin. Especially in the peasantry of Denmark, the farm communities in Denmark, they would make their brooms out of barley straw, and the barley straw brooms would be lucky if they make it for a year. So though all during the year, these brooms have swept up dirt and bad things. And so it's time to get rid of that broom and then after the barley harvest, make a new broom. But they would not burn them right away because towards the end of Sankt Hans Aften, we bring out bread, which we bake on the fire, which is called snowbro. And snowbro is then baked by wrapping the bread around the broom handle and putting the broom in the fire, twisting the broom so that it burns evenly. And of course, the purpose of the bread has a secondary purpose. It's very good. And you put very coarse salt on it, similar to the salt you see on a pretzel. But it also serves to add a degree of sobriety to those who have been enjoying schnapps and beer for the earlier part of the evening. The broom we've already talked about, the witch we've already talked about, but the candle is an interesting tradition. And that is, remember that the pagan belief about Sankt Hans Aften is that if you stay around and keep the fire going and nobody goes to sleep, then the sun will not go south, and we will have summer year long. In case there's one slacker who falls asleep or who doesn't make it to sunrise, the candle is your insurance policy, so that you light the candle from the fire, take the candle home. In the rural areas of Denmark, 200 years ago, they would use the candle to light their way home. They would take the candle home and make sure that they light their Yule log on the winter solstice. If they used their Sankt Hans Aften candle to light the Yule log on their winter solstice, if one person does it, the sun will come back north. And so far, luckily, we don't know who, we don't know where, but every year somebody does light their Yule log with a Sankt Hans Aften candle. So that's the importance of that candle.
How about St. John's wort?
Oh, yeah. St. John's wort blooms right around Sankt Hans Aften, St. John's Day. Young lovers would go out in the woods and pick, hopefully find St. John's wort. If they didn't find that, they would find some other wildflower. And each of them would pick the wildflower and tie it to a branch above them before they fell asleep. And then in the morning, if the Nissa favored their relationship, the Nissa would have the two flower stems intertwine. And of course, sometimes the Nissa might get help from the boy, and sometimes the Nissa might get help from the girl, and sometimes from both. But magically, if the Nissa, if the flowers intertwined, the St. John's wort intertwined, magically, then within the next year, they would be married. And so it became a romantic ritual, another tradition that is practiced at a great degree of risk. So you have to remember that everybody is building this fire as big, as big, as big as they can. And young couples would try to jump over the fire holding their hands together. And if they were successful, that was another sign of a successful romance to be to come. I have had people jump over the fire, and it has been towards sunrise, so that when they jump over the fire towards sunrise, the fire has gone down and it's easier to jump over.
Mm-hmm. It also occurs to me that one more essential element of Sankt Hans Aften must be helping to gather the wood.
Yes. So there, at around 4 or 5 o'clock, people start to arrive and go out. The job is to go out in the woods to build as big of a bonfire as we can. I don't know how big the biggest bonfire has been, but I am sure we've had bonfires where the flames were in excess of 40 feet. And so it is, there's plenty of wood around where I live, and so therefore we're not short of fuel. And in the week before, a whole bunch of people come with their pickup trucks and quietly drop more wood off. It's a real community event. And so I never know how big the fire is going to be.
Are there expectations about the food and beverages of this party?
In Denmark, it would be sometimes small amounts of smørrebrød, which is open-faced sandwiches, but really pølse that is roasted on the fire, similar to a weenie roast in the United States. Akavit means water of life, and it is consumed in profusion at all Sankt Hans Aftens and at mine. I want to show you my akavit glass, which is called a Lille Gilde glass, made in Denmark. And a traditional akavit glass is one that does not have a base to it, so that the only way you can put it down is upside down, which means that when you are given akavit, you are required to empty it in order to put the glass down on its bottom. That makes it a little problematic when there's a large amount of akavit and a lot of time. So what I do to solve that problem is I have the little Gilde glass with a strap around my neck so that I can make it till sunrise without a problem.
And I know you've also been kind of used Sankt Hans Aften as a crash course in Danish culture for those who attend.
At my Sankt Hans Aften, well, a prelude to that is you have to remember everybody is welcome. Everybody is expected to attend. In Decorah, where I live, I like to expose people who come who may not be Danish or may not be Norwegian to the food culture of Denmark. And so each year I do it, I serve at least 30 different kinds of smørrebrød. People try all of the different foods that the authentic Danish and a considerable amount of Norwegian food has, because Decorah is historically of Norwegian immigrants, a considerable amount of Norwegian food as well. Norway celebrates Sankt Hans Aften too. I'm almost always assured of having 30 different kinds of akavit, some that I brought back from Norway, some that I've brought back from Denmark, some that are homemade and some that you can purchase in the United States.
So can you describe a little bit about your preparations and what are the essential elements of a Dennis Larson Sankt Hans Aften?
It's different than Sankt Hans Aften in Denmark. One of the things that I miss that I just cannot get Americans to do in Denmark, all you have to do is give a middle C and the Danes will start off singing and they'll sing throughout the night. For the life of me, I cannot get the people who attend Sankt Hans Aften to sing. I don't understand why not, because in the Danish communities where I grew up and celebrated Sankt Hans Aften, singing was definitely a part of Sankt Hans Aften. And so that's a part that's missing, and I can't figure out why.
You grew up in Southwest Iowa.
I did.
Around Elkhorn, Kimbleton, Harlan. So where were Sankt Hans Aftens held during your childhood?
The first Sankt Hans Aften I went to that I can remember is when I was 4 years old. And in that event, we all gathered out on a farm. It was the Herman and Inger Nielsen farm near Kirkman. And we were all there around a fire and we're roasting hot dogs and marshmallows maybe. And Inger comes flying out of the house, dressed like a banshee. The robes were just flowing and carrying up high up in the air this witch that she had spent hours building. And when that happened, we knew that we were in trouble because the fire was not big enough. So she would bring this huge pole with this witch on top, put it in the middle of the fire. She had, prior to arranging the fire, she had put a pile of sand so she knew that her stake would be stuck in the sand and would stay there. And then we had to go back into the woods and gather more and more firewood until we could get that witch on fire. Sankt Hans Aften moved from one location to the other, but one of the other places that it went to was to the Overgaards, which are within the Happy Dane community right south of Kimbleton. But other of my Happy Dane relatives rotate in having Sankt Hans Aften. So that was my first experience, and I had many more pleasurable experiences after that. I've never had a bad Sankt Hans Aften, even when it rained like cats and dogs.
Well, and I should mention that you mentioned attending Sankt Hans Aften at the Overgaard place. And of course, Annette, the oldest daughter of the Overgaard family, she continues to make the witch for the Museum of Danish America. And that's another kind of featured how-to video for us to share this week. So it's a good long tradition that she's helping to pass on.
Annette and I are cousins. I remember all of the women who would come would bring a dish, kind of like potluck. And one of the, of course, required dishes was leopostei, liver paste. And the women, I think, I don't know this, Annette would know, the women determined who had the best liver paste because they would view how little of liver paste was left. So my mother figured this out, and so she would have a smaller batch of liver paste on a bigger plate so that it would appear that more people ate her liver paste than ate Najesta Overgaard's liver paste or any of the other people that attended.
That's very clever. So this year is, a different year for many tradition events and things that usually we would gather together and celebrate. But this year we hope that people will find ways to incorporate a Sankt Hans Aften celebration in their own homes on a family level. Do you have any advice for folks who have their their backyard to work with and whatever is in their refrigerator?
Well, first, of course, the most important thing is the fire.
It could be a candle in an apartment or a tiki torch on a patio. You know, not everyone is able to light a fire, but.
Well, that's true too. That's true too. And the second, probably the most important thing, comes at the end of the event with the snowbro. And those are things that kids can really get into doing. But you must stay up until sunrise. And without a big party and without other people doing things, that's going to be a little hard to do. But in the backyard of a family outing, playing games singing songs, singing in Denmark is so vital.
And it doesn't mean singing Danish songs necessarily. It's just really the act of people together in community singing the songs that are shared in the culture. So,
Yes, and anything you sing is just fine.
All right. Dennis, this has been great. Are there any other kind of tidbits and stories that are burning to be shared?
What I want to know is, how are you celebrating Sankt Hans Aften this year?
We will be lighting a fire at the museum, even though our building is not open. What we hope it works is that, you know, we'll be able to live stream the museum's fire so that anyone who can't have their own or who wants to see them both can kind of tune in and be part of the virtual party. So
you'll have the fire going until sunrise?
That is to be determined. I know the museum, you know, has evolved its own version of this tradition. Dennis, thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you
for being our guide.
Ladies, Sankt Hans Aften.